Okay, so welcome everyone. So we have today Chris van der Ven from Trento on asymptotic equivalence of two strict deformation quantizations and applications to the classical limit. Please, Chris.
Welcome everybody. Thank you for this opportunity. So in this talk, I will give you, I hope if you can hear, if you can't hear me, please let me know. If some problem, let me know. I will give some a talk about the asymptotic equivalence of two different strict deformation quantizations and applications to spontaneous symmetry breaking and the classical limit. So I'm working as a PhD student at the University of Trento under supervision of Walter Moretti, my supervisor. Okay, let's go on. Why did it, okay, so the plan of my seminar is first I will start with a small introduction on what I want to say, etc. Then I will start, give the basics on strict deformation quantization, a concept maybe not known for everybody, but extremely useful in my work and my the things I'm studying. I will give some examples, some basic examples to illustrate the strict deformation quantization. Then I will come to a theorem, which the joint work with Walter Moretti, my supervisor, about the bulk boundary asymptotic equivalence of two strict deformation quantizations. The details will be given soon. And I will say something about application. So what can you do with this? Is it in which sense it's useful, applied to classical limits and spontaneous symmetry breaking. So let's start with the introduction. So I first give you some works, some papers. The first paper is a joint work with Klaas Landsman, my former supervisor of my master thesis, and my current supervisor, Walter Moretti, of the PhD. There in this work we proved the strict deformation quantization. This word map is a mistake, by the way. Word map you should not read on the state space of the matrices, and we showed the classical limit of some spin model, some Curie-Weiss spin model, kind of a mean field quantum spin system that has been published this year. The second work is a joint work with my supervisor Moretti. That's exactly which I want to speak in this seminar, the bulk boundary asymptotic equivalence of two strict deformation quantizations. Basically, it's shown that a strict deformation quantization can be linked in some sense, connected. Details will follow soon. And the last work is not yet published, sent it 3 months ago. It's a work of myself. It gives proves the classical limit of mean field theories in the sense that we will see soon. So let's start with the introduction. So basically, we studied the transition between quantum and classical theories. That's the basic topic of this seminar. And the main topics we shall discuss are kind of the important physical applications, interesting physical applications, in my opinion. The existence of classical limits of quantum or quantum spin systems. There's a relation with spontaneous symmetry breaking, a typical phenomenon which occurs in the limit of in some sense. It is not there in the quantum system, but in the corresponding classical theory, it pops up, and this framework will explain this in a mathematical rigorous way. So that's basically the applications. And as I said, a useful instrument to study those two physical phenomena are based on the concept of strict deformation quantization. So this is a mathematical correct theory which connect quantum with classical theories. One should be aware that that's the footnote there. Not all classical quantum theories can be connected. There's just a few pairs which have that specific relation in this way. using strict information quantization. It's important to be aware that it seems beautiful, but it is also restricted in the sense that not all theories can be described using this framework. So let's move on to the basics on the strict information quantization. So this is basically you need for this a continuous bundle of C-style algebras, the main ingredient of a strict information quantization. Without this, you have nothing to define it. So the ingredients are then given by a sequence of C-style algebras indexed by some parameter. I call it H bar in order to, the reason for this will become clear soon. Over a locally compact Hausdorff space I, where H zero, so H bar equal to zero, is typically given by C zero of X. So in this case, the zero in my notation means functions vanishing at infinity, continuous functions vanishing at infinity over where X is smooth for some manifold, possibly with boundary. And so those are the main ingredients. Then we consider a class of elements, sequences in this algebras, these algebras that is closed with respect to pointwise sums, pointwise products, adjoint, and such that those two conditions hold. So basically, we make this finite, this norm, in a supreme in this sense. By hand, we just ask those conditions, and we ask also the C star identity for such elements. Then by construction, obviously, such elements, such sequences, such that those conditions are satisfied, is a C star algebra with norm given by one. So what did we do? We start with a sequence of C star algebras over some base space I. We ask some conditions on the elements, and then you construct a C star algebra. Given this, a continuous bundle of C star algebras over I consists then of such a C star algebra just constructed. A collection of such C star algebra A H bar indexed by the H bar in some locally compact Hausdorff space I. And you need also surjective star homomorphisms, phi h bar from the space A to the space A h bar, to the fibers. So basically, what does phi h do? You take an arbitrary sequence and you project onto the h bar component. That's basically what it does, nothing more. And we also require that any function on the base space, we have that the corresponding element, this sequence, is still in A. It's not obvious. It's often true, but not obvious. We need that every for every continuous function vanishes infinity on the base space I, that, and finally the corresponding sequence in this way is indeed in A. The most important property is the continuity property for the norm, in that for each A and A, one has that this function is indeed, so H bar will be sent to the H bar component of the sequence A. The norm with respect to the A H bar C star algebra there is indeed vanishing at infinity, is continuous vanishing at infinity on this base space. So if all these conditions are satisfied, then continuous cross sections if you define it like this, there are different definitions possible. Continuous cross sections are then just elements of A, sequences from I to AH bar, such that those properties are valid, and then these are just elements of A. In this fashion, you can, of course, identify elements of A with the continuous cross section. That's very useful, as we will see now, if you make this construction. So this is basically the first ingredient necessary for a strict information quantization that continues bundle of C star algebras. So a strict information quantization consists then of a continuous bundle of C star algebras over I with A H zero this space Poisson algebra. But in fact, we need a dense. It suffices to have a dense Poisson subalgebra H0 tilde, I call it tilde because notation, of A0. A0 could be anything, but we need a dense Poisson subalgebra on which the quantization maps are defined, as you see here. Quantization maps are in fact going from a dense subspace of the classical space, phase space, to H bar, such that some properties hold. The first property is for H bar equal to zero, we need the inclusion map. Each Q H bar should be a linear map. And we need some conditions. We ask some conditions on Q H bar. I will give now those conditions. So we need the first condition is that the unit function on the manifold X should be mapped to the unit operator for any H bar. It should preserve the star. So this could be complex conjugation, and this is then the adjoint of the operator. One of the most important properties is that the sequence 0 to F and H bar will map to this operator should define indeed a section of the bundle. So as I said, an element of A should be an element of A, continuous section of the bundle should define. And maybe the most important property is for all elements in the dense Poisson subalgebra, we need the condition that the quantum commutator rescaled with this factor H bar, I over H bar, should in norm converge to the Poisson bracket, to the image, to QH bar of the Poisson bracket. So this relates already quantum with classical mechanics, because this is something quantum that lives on the non-commutative AH bar algebras. And this is something which lives on the C0 of X, on the A0, the classical algebra. And then we demand this property here. And note one thing, that you have to rescale with H bar. Without this rescaling, this bracket goes to zero, because such quantization maps, there's a lot of examples. For example, if you consider macroscopic observables, observables given by averages, they asymptotically already commute. So that means that this already goes to zero for H bar small enough. So in this sense, we really need the scaling factor there to make this work. So that is the definition of a strict deformation quantization of a Poisson manifold. That's the first thing. I now give you some examples, because maybe it's not completely obvious. Let's go on. So we considered Berezin quantization on R to N. So I will explain you. We consider that the algebra C0 contains function vanishes on infinity of R two to the power N, which we indicate for H bar equal to zero. Then for H bar not equal to zero, we take the compact operators on the Hilbert space L2 of Rn. It's clear that this is a Poisson manifold equipped with the standard symplectic Poisson structure. It can be proved that this A0 and AH bar forms exactly a fiber, which are the fibers of a continuous bundle of C star algebra over this space, which is compact. So it's not completely obvious, but you can show that indeed those fibers indeed define a continuous bundle of C star algebras. That's the first step. For the quantization, then, how could one define a quantization? Now we take the dense subspace of this space, the compactly supported functions, those are clearly dense in the function vanishing infinity, to the compact operators. And how is this map defined? It's given by the integral of R to N of a function f, the point PQ, which we indicate by the phase space, P is an element of Rn and Q is an element of Rn, no physical notation, of the projectors phi H bar PQ. Those operators are typical the projection onto the subspace spanned by the unit vector. And this is indicated by a Schrödinger coherent state. I don't get the exact definition of a Schrödinger coherent state, but basically it is a vector in the Hilbert space, which is parameterized by points in the classical phase space R to N. In this sense, you can make it as a unit vector. So you associate a projection operator to it, indicated by this notation, onto the one-dimensional subspace spanned by this vector. This is indeed a compact operator. This is the usual Lebesgue measure, and this is a scaling factor, 2 pi h bar to the nth. So exactly this, one can show that indeed this map satisfies the conditions. For example, the self-adjointness is obvious, the linearity also. Let's check a bit. The fact that if you take the identity function, the unit function there, then this should provide the identity operator on the compact operators. That's true since Schrödinger coherent states, they satisfy a resolution of the identity. I don't want to go into details, but there's quite a well-known theorem about Schrödinger coherent states. So this then proves the existence of a strict deformation quantization of this Poisson manifold, this one. And why it's called Berezin quantization, in a sense that it's also positive. Since that is f is a positive function, then QH bar f is positive. So that's just a name. It's not really important for this example. Let's move on. I give another example, maybe more interesting for spin systems. We shall see later. So we examine is a Berezin quantization of the on the two sphere. So the two sphere in a subset of R3. So we consider a space H0, A prime 0. It's the continuous functions on the two sphere. That should be played the role of the classical algebra. Then the quantum algebra, so for 1 over n larger than 0, are the matrices of dimension n plus 1, all matrices of dimension n plus 1. And one can indeed show that these are the fibers of a continuous bundle of C star algebra over the discrete space. So here I mean the 1, 1 and a half, 1 over 3, 1 over 4, so the inverse of natural numbers. But you should also take the 0 because you want here the 0. So you should include that point. The Poisson structure is given by this function. It's not difficult to see. It's a basic theory that the Poisson bracket is given in this. With this Poisson structure, it works. Those functions f and g, they are basically defined. These are smooth functions defined on R3, but then you can restrict them to the sphere, to S2, and you can show that everything is works, everything works, there are no problems. So this indeed defines a Poisson bracket on S2, the two sphere. But to define the quantization maps, we are interested in a dense subspace, because on those such space, not always clear if you can define a quantization map on a whole space. So the basic choice is, of course, take polynomials in three real variables restricted to the sphere S2. That is what we did. Indeed, quantization maps for identified on such polynomials in this way. So what is this? We take a polynomial and we map it to under this map to the integral over the two sphere, this the measure on the sphere, d mu omega. P omega is just the function evaluated in omega, and those, this again, as we saw before, those are coherent states. This time no Schrödinger coherent states, but called spin coherent states, are related to a group action of SU2. So it's a bit complicated to give all the details, but basically it is the same as before. Those factors omega n are parameterized by a point on the two sphere, and then if you can make the projection onto the linear span of those vectors, which yields an operator, and then they indeed define a resolution of identity, in the sense that if you take a unit function, then n plus 1 over 4 pi integral S2, the mu omega of this operator is the identity operator, the unit operator on the matrices. So these are specific states, operators, which are very useful to define quantization maps, the Schrödinger coherent states, the spin coherent states. And the next example we provide, you don't have this. You don't have this. You don't have coherent state. So you should define it in another way. We will see that now. So, okay. So to give a small summary, we have seen the quantization of R to N in terms of Schrödinger coherent states. Now we have seen an example of a quantization of continuous function on a two-sphere in terms of spin coherent states, which is all the properties necessary. And the next example is a bit more complicated. We now consider A0 are the continuous functions of the state space of the 2x2 matrices. So the algebraic states are meaning positive linear functionals of norm 1. But I indicate the symbol that has those states of the 2x3 matrices. And this isomorphism is true because the state space of 2x2 matrices is isomorphic to this is the closed unit 3 ball in R3. So it's the boundary the two sphere. That's what I mean. It happens nothing. I just say that the states over the 2x2 matrices is isomorphic to the closed unit 3 ball in R3. So this algebra is you can prove that those are the fibers. Here you need a tensor product of a continuous bundle of C star algebras over exactly the same base space as we saw before. So the quantum algebra, the non-commutative algebra, is the tensor product of M two times two matrix with itself. So it is completely different as we saw before. Before we had here just a fixed, we increased the dimension, and now it is we increase the tensor product. So the dimension becomes 2 to the power n. In order to define the Poisson structure, that goes exactly in a similar fashion. We take two functions on the two smooth function R3, which we restrict to function a closed unit ball, and we define it in this way. I need to put a G. If you see it as a mistake, I'm sorry for this. I forgot. Okay, so this is basically this is the Poisson bracket, and epsilon is the Levi-Civitas symbol, as you all know. If you see, why I put the G? Like it can happen. So basically, this is the Poisson bracket defined on this space. And in order to find quantization maps, we need, as before, a dense subalgebra of CB of 3. It is not obvious how to do this. We don't have coherent states in this setting, as we saw here, because the tree ball, the closed unit tree ball, is not related to a group or to SU2 or to some action, to some quotient of some group as S2, the two sphere. So in this case, it's more difficult to know what the quantization maps are. So, but we thought a long time, and at the end, they are defined by quasi-symmetric sequences. So that means macroscopic observables. There is a result proved by Lanzmann, and he knew that this quantization map should be in this defined in this way. But to define a dense subalgebra, it's not obvious. But one thing, microscopic observables, they're typical observables who start in a finite way. But the infinite tail, so these are tensor products, they consist of average observable, and therefore they asymptotically commute. So think about a tensor product of a lot of a finite number of operators, and then infinitely many identities added, and then you symmetrize the whole part, and then exactly you define a macroscopic observable. So we asymptotically commute. Before this, we need an intermezzo. Well, what is exactly a quasi-symmetric sequence? Maybe it's not clear to all of you, so I will give a small intermezzo explaining this. So you start with a symmetrizing operator, SN. It starts from the algebra, so A1 and so give is the tensor product of 2x2 matrix with itself. It goes to the same algebra, it does the same as the symmetrized operation vector space. Namely, it symmetrizes the elementary tensors in this way. Then, for m larger than m, larger than equal to m, we define a bounded operator in this way by continuous and linear extension of this map. So we take an operator in a smaller algebra, we add a lot of identities to obtain an element in A 1 over n, and then we symmetrize the whole object. That would be, this is the new object, and a symmetric sequence is exactly called, a sequence is exactly called symmetric, if we can find such an M, AM and A1 over M, such that it's given in this way. So recall that it means that this is the definition. We take a finite number of operators, let's say. We add a lot of identities, we symmetrize the whole object, and then then we let M to infinity, and that's called a symmetric sequence, exactly in this way. But there's a weak condition, a quasi-symmetric sequence. Then it is symmetrized for any fixed N, we should have this, but it can be approximized by a symmetric sequence in norm, in the sense that for every epsilon, we can find a symmetric sequence approximation the quasi-symmetric sequence, this one. So a quasi-symmetric sequence is a weaker version, and it's always approximated by the symmetric sequence in norm. So those are the two notions of symmetry in this setting. And Lanzmann proved that continuous cross-section of the bundle A0, so the continuous functions of the state space of the two-term serial matrices with the tensor product of the two-term serial matrix with itself and full tensor product are then precisely given by quasi-symmetric sequences, and they uniquely define this bundle as a theorem proved by Lanzmann. So if you know this, then you know also how you would define the quantization maps, because quantization maps should define, if you go a second back, they should define a section of the bundle. So sections of the bundles are given by quasi-symmetric sequences. So we know now, the quantization map should indeed give a quasi-symmetric sequence. But that made us think that was the first step to go to the dense Poisson subalgebra, on which we define those quantization maps. And we will give now a small overview on how we constructed this subspace, this subalgebra. So we take a subspace of the tensor product, the direct sum of the tensor product with itself. But this subspace specific is made of symmetric tensor products. We then define from this subspace, we can define a map defined by linear extension of the following map. So what do? You take an element here. You take a symmetric tensor product, and then you apply it to a state omega, and then you define it easily by omega bj1 omega by the product. So omega, it is defined in this way. Omega n means tensor product of omega with itself, which products into this, factorize into this way. Those elements here form a base of the Lie algebra of SU2, where omega is exactly such a state. And it is easy to see that omega is a tracer state because we have matrices. It's easy to see that it's given by the coordinates. That's a basic exercise because omega is a trace of a density matrices over. It's a tracer state that you can, it's an easy computation for 2x2 matrices. It's a very easy computation to prove that it's exactly this coordinate. There is one remark. We prove this for general kappa, for general matrices. But for this application, I just showed you the 2x2 matrices, but it holds also for general arbitrary dimension. That's what I mean. You can extend the whole theory here to arbitrary dimension. Anyway, you can show that this map chi. So taking a symmetric tensor product and giving a, which is, it's making a continuous function, it's well-defined linear injective map. So by the Weierstrass theorem, the image of Z on this map is a dense. And so elements of chi zeta are polynomials, as you see, omega b j I are just coordinates. They are polynomials. I take linear combinations, so you get a polynomial. So for each polynomial of degree L corresponds uniquely to a polynomial of the symmetric elementary tensor in this form. That is the first observation, which was crucial to define the quantization maps for to define the dense subspace and hence the quantization maps. So exactly what we did, we defined the dense Poisson subalgebra in this way, the image of Z under this map. And for such a function PL in this way, the quantization map are then defined by continuous and linear extension of this maps. So this PL uniquely corresponds to a tensor product, and then we define it like this. You can show it's well defined, it satisfies all the properties of a strict deformation quantization, including the Dirac-Grunewald Revo condition, which is not easy to show because it is you have a lot of permutations, so you have to count very well to make this work, but it's not impossible. And you should notice also that the quantization map indeed define a section of the bundle, a symmetric sequence. It's, if you go a second back, a symmetric sequence is given in this way. And the quantization map are indeed given as define a symmetric sequence as it should be, because they should define a section of the bundle which are given by quasi-symmetric and symmetric sequences. So, and therefore they define macroscopic observables which, I repeat, asymptotically commute. So that's basically the third example I give. You see also no coherent states are involved there. You don't see spin coherent states of projections onto some vector. It's nothing, it's a completely different way. In fact, this quantization map is also not positive. Anyway, so those were the examples. I now give. I now want to go a step further to link this quantization map, this one, equation 10, with this map. There's a work which have been done by me and Moretti, my supervisor. In order to do this, we should be aware that there is an n plus one dimensional symmetric subspace in the tensor product. If you take this symmetric tensor product of this, Anyway, you take the symmetric tensor product of the tensor product, and you get and which is dimension n plus one. So what we did, we took exactly operators as we defined there. So those are elements of the tensor product and full tensor product. We restricted easily to the symmetric part of the tensor product. That's what we did. So this, since those operators leave them invariant, this defines an operator, a bounded operator on the symmetric part of the tensor product, which is of dimension n plus one. So this is identified by the n plus one matrices. Note that this is a mistake. It should be a B before. This is, but I think it's clear. So the message is the quantization maps given by symmetric sequences, they leave the n plus one dimensional symmetric subspace of the n-fold tensor product invariant. So restricting such an operator quantization map to that subspace yield an operator on n plus one matrices. And that then yields the following theorem relating both quantization maps. So we take a polynomial on the vector space of polynomials in the three real variables on the closed unit ball, B3. And then we consider the quantization map as we had before on the sphere. you simply take the polynomial restricted to the sphere, which can be done. I mean, this is a polynomial on the unit ball. The boundary is the sphere. You restrict to the sphere. You can quantize this function. It's completely well defined. It yields an operator on this space. And then we take the quantization as we had before, namely this one, and we restrict it because it leaves the symmetric surface invariant. It restricts to such an operator. So those two operators live on the same space. We take the difference and we show the norm that this goes to zero. And the operator norm is then, of course, the one being on the bound operator on this vector space. So n plus one times n plus one matrices. So this is a theory we prove with Walter Moretti. It is maybe it seems a bit strange, but this is called the name bulk boundary. Bulk is then it indicates the tree ball, and boundary then the two sphere, the boundary of the tree ball. And they are asymptotic equivalent in the sense that, in this sense, that in a norm, the difference goes to zero as n goes to infinity. So that's basically what I want to say about the theory. And now I want to give some applications. Where's that useful for? What do we have? What can we do with this? So let's move on. We consider a collection of n twofold two-level atoms corresponding to a spin chain of n sides, described by a so-called mean field Hamiltonian. A typical example is the quantum Kurzweil spin Hamiltonian defined on this Hilbert space. So it's given by this Hamiltonian. So J indicates a coupling constant that could be taken to 1, and B is a magnetic field typically between 0 and 1. And now to read this, this is sigma 3 of I is the spin Pauli matrix, the third spin Pauli matrix, and sigma 1 of I the first. And this should be seen as a tensor product, so it should be an element of this. So you add identities, and then only on the I component, you put sigma 3, the rest is identity. So to the 2 times 2 matrix. And the same holds, of course, for this. So that this indeed makes sense on this space. So also this Hamiltonian, a mean field Hamiltonian, typically leaves the symmetric subspace invariant. You can prove it. It's not so difficult. And another important property is that Hn, this operator, defines a quasi-symmetric sequence. And that gives the relation with spontaneous with the strict deformation quantization. So we can show that this Hamiltonian, equation 12, minus the quantization of some class, some function, indeed goes to zero, which is the definition of a quasi-symmetric sequence. It should be approximated by a symmetric sequence. And thus we have seen that the quantization maps, they indeed define symmetric sequences. By definition, these are defined in terms of symmetrizer. So this means that we have an operator which leaves a symmetric subspace invariant, and it is a quasi-symmetric sequence in this sense. And the function quantize, which you, the classical function here, is also called the classical Kurzweil model because it relates directly to the quantum model. So by the theorem, we can apply a theorem in this sense, namely those the operators, sequence of operators, Hamiltonians, if you restrict them to the symmetric subspace, which leaves it invariant, if you do the difference with the quantization map of this function restricted to the two sphere. So recall that the quantization map Q prime 1 over n was given in terms of integral over the two sphere with coherent spin coherent states. So and by the theorem, this goes to zero. So this means then that the restricted mean field, restricted in the sense that you restrict it to the symmetric subspace, mean field space is represented by quantization of the Bloch sphere and the semi-classical limit 1 over h bar is n in this setting as n goes to infinity. But this is interesting because a spin system is related by a strict deformation quantization of a functional sphere, which has a lot of applications, exactly as we shall see now. So quantization theory also yields sometimes existence of a classical limit of algebraic states when we take a limit with respect to quantum mechanical observables. For example, the main question is to answer, does this object here, which is the limit of a state depending on h bar of such observables, we take observables quantization maps, exist as a state on the classical algebra, where x then plays, of course, the role of the classical phase space. And the questions one can ask oneself is, which states admit such a classical limit? Think of, for example, pure vector states, local gap states, etc. Characterizing those limiting states is also an important topic, which is not clear. Now, I give the last part of the talk, we give two examples when this is true. The first example is quite interesting, but not difficult. It's the one-dimensional Schrödinger operator. So this is an unbound operator. And we take the second order derivative. We take the double well potential, and then probably the means that the spectrum is discrete because there's compact resolvent for double well potential. So this eigenvectors exist, and we take then the smallest eigenvector corresponding the smallest eigenvalue with corresponding eigenvector psi h bar zero. If we then define the corresponding vector states, there's a unit vector, and then we show that one can show that the Bayesian quantization, as defined before, but now we take R2 instead of R2n, induce indeed the existence of the classical limit, namely this vector state, there's a vector state applied to observables from this form, so the quantization maps, indeed define a classical limit. And what is this object? Those are direct measures, so point measures defined in the minima of the well, of both wells, of the both wells, the double wells. You have the left well and the right well, so those minima. Evaluation of the function in the minima of the well. That's basically what happens. So this indeed shows the existence of the classical limit for this specific example. Maybe a more interesting example, I don't know. That is what we will see now. Related to the spin system as we mentioned before. You recall the Hamiltonian defined in this way, as we have seen before, exactly the same formula. So one can prove that such a Hamiltonian has a unique ground state eigenvector up to phase. And then also one can define a vector state in this way, and defines a state in this way. One can prove that indeed this state converges with respect to macroscopic observables. In the sense that macroscopic observables are given by quantization maps by symmetric sequences. So one can then take images of quantization maps of such functions. And that exactly indeed defines a state on the classical algebra CSM2C. So contains function on the tree ball, closed unit tree ball. This is what I proved a couple of months ago. So the point is here that this vector state apply to quantization maps given by symmetric sequences, which define macroscopic observables, indeed yield a state on this algebra. This is a quite interesting result. Also in this case, it is given by the state given by symmetric sum of two individual states, Dirac measures, which correspond to the Dirac measures by Ries theorem, and given the minima of the classical quantized function. So we have seen that we have seen before that this model corresponds to a classical symbol, classical Q-Rise model here. And exactly this function is this function. So basically we show that the classical limit of the quantum Q-Rise model converges to a symmetric convex sum of two direct measures given by corresponding to the minima of the classical function given in this way. Well, B is still the magnetic field. So there's an interesting result, and also one should be aware that now the parameter h of n plays, of course, role of h bar. So And this also used spontaneous symmetry breaking. This proved directly spontaneous symmetry breaking in the classical limit. That can be seen in the following way. If spontaneous symmetry breaking, of course, then pure ground states are not invariant anymore, whilst invariant ground states are not pure. This is clearly an invariant ground state. It's invariant on the set Z2 symmetry. If you interchange plus and minus, it changes nothing. They are invariant, but it's not a pure state. So we have spontaneous symmetry breaking. Because for finite n in the classical, in the quantum model, the ground state was unique, meaning that you cannot have n pure, that you cannot have, it was unique, pure, and invariant. So you have no symmetry breaking. Only in the limit you see the phenomenon popping up. It decomposes in a symmetric sum of two pure states, so it's not pure anymore, but invariant. The same result is true for the Schrödinger operator, of course. This is an invariant, not pure state. And for quantum, this vector is clearly it was unique. It was invariant, so we have no symmetry breaking for the quantum case. So the last thing I want to say is I want to give a small plot of maybe to visualize these findings. So for the quantum Kurzweil model, this model, I plotted the ground state eigenvector. So this is this vector for n is 50. So you basically see that the pure ground state eigenvector of this model is inbound on the Z2 reflecting symmetry. If you reflect this, this changes nothing. As you see, if n increases, in fact, we see this. It kindly, you see it decomposing, you see it slowly, this minus 500 decomposing into two parts. And in the limit, exactly this happens. The invariant ground state, this is invariant on the symmetry, converges to a, in the sense I just explained, into two parts, into a, the symmetric sum of those individual states, which become point measures in the minima of the classical function, which then defines clearly an invariant state, but it's not pure anymore. So the chain, the state decomposes into two equally contributing parts. And that explains then the symmetry breaking in the classical limit for this model. So yes, this was basically my presentation. If you have some questions or comments, please let me know. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Chris, for this nice talk. Any question or comment, remark, anything?
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Why would you expect the limit to be pure?
We cannot hear you wherever you are.
Okay, try again. Can you hear me now?
Yes. Ah, Richard.
Hi. So, yeah, hi. Why would you expect the limit state to be pure, actually? I'm a bit confused.
No, we don't expect. Expect the limit state to be pure. We expect it. We know from physical observations that the limiting state would break the symmetry. But then the limiting.
No, you did tell me that limiting state is symmetric. It preserves the symmetry. It's still Z2 symmetric. The one the sum, it's still Z2 symmetric. It's not pure, but it's still symmetric.
Yes, but it's invariant, exactly, but it's not pure anymore. That's why the spontaneous symmetry breaking occurs.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking. Why would you expect it to be pure, ever? Because
the limit.
Yeah, the limit. Yeah. Why would the limit be pure? I'm slightly confused. Yeah. So now you talk about these continuous fields, right? Deformation. So if you think the simplest one, Ripple's one, right? Deformation of R, R2, okay? So for H different from zero, you have compact operators.
Yes.
For H equal to zero, you get C0 R2, right? And now what's happening is for H different from zero and compact operators, you obviously have, you have a ground state. Right, as a German generator of K0.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. Now, what's happening when your parameter h goes to zero is that your ground state blows up. because something got from e to minus x squared over h bar. Right?
But this you're considering. Yes, just the deformation
of R2, right? You have this ground state for h different from zero, which is given by vector e to minus x squared over h bar. That blows up as h goes to zero, right? The one thing that does survive is the corresponding k-tier element, right? So the k0 class, that's continuous. And you end up with a different difference projection for h equals zero. But the pure states, there is no reason that pure states survive as pure states in the limit.
Okay. Yes.
Actually, yes. Your symmetry is preserved here, right? It's still symmetric. Purity does not. Purity does not survive. Purity, its pure state is very much dependent on the structure of your algebra, whether the state is pure or not. Okay, so no, it will not be pure state because, but you never expect it to be pure states. You never expect a quantum state to become a point evaluation somewhere in the limit, in the semi-classical limit.
Okay. And basically, my notion of symmetry breaking is defined for pure states. In this way,
I guess. So on the
extreme boundary, so for pure states, pure ground states. So if it is invariant, it cannot be pure. That's just what I mean.
Yeah, but that's kind of automatic, right? In this case, it has nothing to do with semi-classical limit. It's the difference in the structure of quantized and classical observable algebra, right?
Yes.
It's just the difference in the structure of algebra. No, the symmetry breaking is still symmetry breaking. So the limiting state has a different symmetry properties. It doesn't here. It preserves the symmetry properties, right? There is something else. Maybe you should say it a bit differently. So what happens is you could think about your ground. It's really ground state you talk about, right? So you can think of it as a KMS state at infinite temperature. And the difference between classical and quantum system is that in the quantum system, there's a unique one. In classical system, you've got a lot of them. So that's this kind of symmetry breaking that happens. It does happen, very much.
Okay.
I was just curious. But question, so I'm curious. So your quantization of B3, what kind of geometric Poisson structure is it? So what's geometric background for that Poisson structure?
Yeah, basically, let me check.
You wrote the formula, of course, right? You have a formula, but what's the geometric?
Basically, state space, I'm interested in the algebraic state, but in this easy case for kappa, if you take the two-term Schur matrix, is equal to B3, but you can generalize this to any dimension.
Yeah, but what's the geometric structure?
I have another knife for some manifold, because the boundary is not.
Well, it is a Poisson manifold. It has to be it's three-dimensional, so it has to be singular. But what's the geometric background for this Poisson structure? Does it have some kind of invariance property, something?
Well, we didn't check that. We were not interested in that specific thing. We were interested in this manifold for arbitrary dimension, and this is a specific case. But that's it.
It gives kind of feeling, right? Like you are deforming kind of homogeneous space of some quantum group action, right? SU to acting and M to C. So like SU to acting on the Lie algebra of SU, on the Lie algebra of SU2, right?
Yes. Yeah, we basically, good question, but we didn't study that. We just studied this for general K kappa for MA, and then there's a specific example, but we didn't check the geometric structure. And
yeah, okay.
Good point. We didn't
okay.
Do that, but it could be interesting. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Thanks. It was a nice talk, by the way. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Any other question? Any other remark? So this is part of Chris's thesis. So we should really encourage him. It was really a very nice talk, Chris. Okay.
It was a very nice talk.
Thank you very much. Chris again.
Thank you very much.
So everybody, see you next week.
Yep.
Take care.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.